Hello, Shannon. Thank you so much and welcome to the show.
Thank you for having me.
It's an honor that you're on and thanks so much for joining us this week. Give us a little bit about your background, where you're from, and a little bit about your journey.
Well, my background, I'm from Houston, Texas, a Texas girl. My background is I was born as an evangelical Christian, into an evangelical Christian family. My father was a minister. I didn't know any better. I don't have any big inspirational stories about how I found Jesus because I was born into it. I was, as youth, trained to evangelize and to convert people, the world, to Christianity, which is a big focus in evangelical Christianity. As an adult, that took a turn towards, it was a focus on converting Jews because Jews are sort of prioritized against the rest of the world.
Why is that? Why are Jews prioritized for?
That gets into the Christian theology, which is the Great Commission is to go forth and bring the gospel to the entire world. But the Jews play a specific role in Christian theology about end times. It is, so they prioritize because while it's great to bring the whole world to Jesus, Jews specifically coming to Jesus triggers the second coming. So
interesting.
Which every Christian wants.
Got it. So now you're an adult and you are, I guess, more focused on Jews.
I was more focused on Jews. I was a pretty decent missionary when the focus was the whole world, but I found trouble when that focus started to be geared towards Jews, because to evangelize a Jew, you really have to get into the text and know the text, because Jews sometimes know what they're talking about.
Okay. So what happens? I'm loving this story. So you get into the text and what happens?
I get into the text. I have to start memorizing all of the prophecies and things in Tanakh that Christians believe refer to Jesus. Uh-huh. And I need to find ways to get Jews to read those verses in Tanakh and see Jesus the same way I see Jesus in those verses, which worked fine when I was discussing those things with conservative reformer or less affiliated Jews who weren't so familiar with the text. But I ran into big problems when I was speaking to Orthodox, which I happen to like being in the Orthodox world. But I wasn't having such an easy time getting them to look at the text the same way. And I wasn't successful in converting any Orthodox Jews. Mm-hmm. They would give me a really hard time. They would taunt me a little bit. They would tell me things like I was taking the verses out of context, that they're mistranslated, and that they were totally made up, which I thought was absurd. They're just regurgitating what their rabbi told them. It was clear that I needed to learn more if I was going to reach more affiliated Jews than what they were talking about. So I had gone back to learning in an effort to become a better missionary and reach the more Orthodox Jews. I started learning more. And as I started learning more, which they told me things were out of context, so I started reading things in context, which they were sort of right, because it really made things more confusing when I read things in context. Didn't exactly refer to Jesus as much as I thought it did, but I was still determined it means Jesus and I'm going to figure this out and I'm still going to reach Jews. But I got so confused in my learning when I read the whole chapter or the whole book and couldn't quite mesh the Jesus part into it, that I decided, you know what, they have a whole bunch of answers and somehow they're getting those answers. So I looked up, how does an Orthodox Jew answer Christianity? So I found the Jewish response to Christian missionaries online and I decided I'm going to study those. And even if I don't have the text just right or can't get the text to work just right, I'll learn how to debate them and I'll bring them in that way. Mm-hmm. So I was learning all of the arguments on how Jews answer Christian missionaries, but in the process started looking at it myself, and everything I believed sort of crumbled, because the rabbis that were providing me those responses were right. And my whole world fell apart and everything I believed in just crumbled, rug out from under you, all that. It was very traumatic.
When was this?
This was back, it was between 2006 and 2007.
How old were you?
I was in my mid to late 20s. I was single with two children.
Wow, that's a lot. So to have the world, your belief system, come like the rug come out from under your feet in your late 20s with two little kids, it's pretty traumatic. I mean, that's
right, because it was a life that I was completely dedicated to. I had no doubt that Jesus was the Messiah, and I was like, there was no doubt at all. That was my life. I was very dedicated to it. It was the core of everything I believed. It was everything I did on a day-to-day basis. I woke up in the morning talking to my imaginary friend, Jesus. I know it's not nice to refer to it that way, but that's basically what it was. Jesus was somebody who was one with me since I was a child. I didn't know any different. So when that person in your eyes is no longer exists, and it was all a lie, it was really devastating. It's like, you know, a major life change, a death, mm-hmm. that you lost the closest person to you, and it was all a lie. That's I think I went through every stage of grief with that discovery, because you're mad, you're angry, you're sad, you feel hopeless, you suddenly have nothing in your life anymore. From when you wake up, everything you do in your day-to-day activities is about my faith. I was reaching people. I was going to church. I was going to classes. You're involved in all of this social. It's your community. It's your support system. It's your family.
So what happened next when you emerged from?
In my anger stage, I cried. I got to a very low place where I really felt hopeless, that there's nothing was important anymore. I had no purpose, nothing even just to do. I lost everything. In anger, I threw a pillow at the wall, crying and screaming out to God. And asking, you know, I was angry at God and talking to God, but then, you know, looked at myself like, you're stupid. God doesn't even exist.
So the whole thing crumbled then.
Right. So when you're in that devastated, hopeless state and you cry out to God and you realize there's not even a God there, it's very low and hopeless. I reached a very low point. I ended up reaching out to the rabbi whose lessons I was learning and saying, I need to know, where do I put Jesus? Like, was he at least a historical figure? Can you tell me that anything I believed in was true? Nothing. And he basically said, you're struggling because you don't know where to, you want to like file everything nicely into a box and say, this is what it was. And you can't, and you really have to ask yourself the question of, was he the Messiah or was he not? If he wasn't, then nothing else matters. I said, but I can't believe that everything I believe, and I have nothing, there's no God. And he said, that's not true. He says, there is a God and he's been with you the whole time. You just don't need that intercessor. You don't need that person between you and God. You have direct access and he's watching you. He knows what you're going through and he's been there your whole life.
Wow.
So that got through to me. I was in Houston. Yes.
Just so I can paint the picture. You are sitting alone in an apartment or a house with two little kids, a life collapsed in Texas. And yes. interacting with the rabbi now through that.
With a rabbi based in New York somewhere.
Right. So what happens next?
That sort of gave me hope. I didn't feel so hopeless. And I did I did believe him. I don't know how he got through to me because I was really low, but I did believe him. And I did feel that I'm not ready to give up on God altogether. I do feel, and I know, and I know, I felt my whole life that my hand was somehow, that God's hand was somehow on my life through everything. I didn't feel a total disconnect. And then I decided I'm not giving up religion altogether, but I want to learn Torah and I want to learn Judaism from the beginning. And it wasn't enough to just say, I'm only going to learn the New Old Testament and I'll still use my Christian Bible. When I realized that my Christian Bible had been messed with, that hurt a lot. I didn't have anything to trust anymore. So I said I was going to learn it completely unfiltered, go back to the original. Hebrew is a little tough to learn, but I'm at least going to get a credible translation. So I would go to Art Scroll, and I wanted to learn Judaism like a child would learn Judaism, like as if I were starting day school. So I would, a lot of online learning. There's not a whole lot open to non-Jews who are looking to learn Torah. But we have Aish, there's a lot of online resources to learn from. So I would subscribe to the Parsha every week and start learning that way. I did connect to a local Chabad who was not so open to me showing up as a non-Jew, who said, I used to be a missionary, but I want to come learn. They weren't too into me hanging out.
That seems like an easy joy. That seems like an easy move in, you know?
Right. But I said I was in the process of looking into the Jewish roots of my family. There might be something there. Otherwise, I'm interested in the conversion process. So he hesitated, but he said I could come for the weekly Parsha lesson, but no more. So I took to learning online and a little bit with Chabad and decided that I wanted to convert to Judaism.
And this is all taking place. This is all taking place online, meaning you haven't yet been to Israel. You haven't yet been in any type of seminary. This is mostly an online journey back.
I had been to Israel just before this process. It was when I was a missionary and trying to reach Orthodox Jews. I did take a trip to Israel with a bunch of secular Israeli friends. And while I was there, we did the whole Tel Aviv thing. And my mother was upset with me saying, you have to go walk in the steps of Jesus at least for one day. So to please my mom, I did go to Jerusalem for one day. I went to the Church of the Holy Sepulchre. And while that, I had sort of been looking into Judaism, and I heard for the first time ever that Christianity was idolatry. And that was offensive to me as a Christian, because I didn't view Christianity as idolatry, because to me, Jesus was God, and it's not a man. The Trinity's a little difficult to explain, but I didn't feel that it was idolatry. I felt Jesus was God, and that's not idolatry in a weird way. So when I went to the Church of Holy Sepulchre, that was powerful, because I went in and there are people crying and kissing the rocks. What is that rock that was supposedly a rock that Jesus's body was laid on? And people were crying on it and kissing it. They had these candles that they had bought, and they were like rubbing the candles on it because it would, like, for holiness. And they had holy water that they were like putting on the rock, and everything in there was kissed by everybody, and they were praying and crying to everything in there. So hearing for the first time that Christianity was idolatry, and then seeing scenes like that at the Church of Holy Sepulchre, wow, this really does feel like idolatry. This is statues, and I hadn't seen it with those eyes before. Mm-hmm. It touched me. I ended up crying leaving the Church of the Holy Sepulchre and said, something's wrong. I did go to the Kotel, And I had my personal prayer that I gave to God saying, I don't know what's what with this whole idolatry thing, but I want you to show whatever it takes, show me the truth. Mm-hmm. And I felt terrible. But then when I got to the Kotel, it was Simchas Torah, and which at the Kotel is a very exciting time to be at the Kotel. There's kids on their daddy's shoulders, and everybody's kissing Torahs, and it was inspirational and nice to be around. I didn't want to leave. Mm-hmm. I stayed for hours and hours just watching everything that was happening on Simchas Torah, and I felt peace there where I had not felt peace at the Church of the Holy Sepulchre. And I sort of in my own way was asking God, what's happening here? What are you showing me?
Mm-hmm. What was the moment where you just said, I'm joining, I'm converting? Like, was there a moment, or was it just a natural progression without any sort of defining moment where you made the change?
It was a natural progression, but when I had learned everything that was wrong, and then learning Torah and Judaism, and looking at the same passages over and over again, and the fact that when you look at Christianity, when I was looking at Christianity, trying to make things make sense, the more I read and the wider I opened things and read things into context, the deeper I delved, the more confusing it got. I could not make sense of it. Mm-hmm. But Torah, I would read the same thing over and over again, and there was different levels. You'd get deeper and deeper and deeper. And the more you looked, the more things came together, the more they made sense. I said, that's significant. The more I look into Torah, the more everything comes together, makes mm-hmm. sense. The more I look into Christianity, the more it falls apart. Mm-hmm. This is huge.
Yeah.
So I decided that Judaism was it, and the traditions, I loved learning the traditions behind, even the minchagim, the little things that people do, that I'd ask a question and it would be a beautiful answer. There's a Sephardi shul I went to, and he put a drop of water into the wine before Kiddush. And I said, I'd never seen that before. Why did you do that? And he said, you know, the cup of wine represents judgment and the water represents God's mercy. And we want a little bit, you know, when we have so much judgment, we want a little bit of mercy to it. And that was beautiful. And then every mitzvot that was described to me, I would ask, why do you do that? I was a like a little child. Why? And everything I got back was just beautiful and had so much meaning. I said, I want this in my everyday life. I want to learn all of the mitzvot, and I want to do all of those beautiful, meaningful things.
Wow. So take us now to where you are now. Like, just take us through, where are you today? How many years has it been? And just sort of bring us now to current and share with us, you know, where you are today in your journey.
Conversion process was quite intense. The Orthodox conversion process is not easy. It took 4 years, but I completed, and almost a year after I completed my conversion, I ended up getting married to somebody in Texas who has a whole bunch of family here in Israel. So we had a wedding in Israel, and I always wanted to move to Israel. And turned out he'd always wanted to move to Israel also, and his whole family was here. So we set out to make that happen. It eventually happened. We got here to Israel. It's a foreign language to me, a foreign culture. I think even to American Jews, Israelis are a foreign culture.
For sure.
It's intense here. I find it physically hard to live in Israel, but spiritually easy. You're like, there's a direct connection. It's a very different feeling when you get. I grew up in Texas, and I never knew any other home other than Texas. I wasn't a traveler. So when I landed in Israel, it was like something stood up inside me and like a whole new soul woke up and felt like it was home, which is crazy because I've never known any other home. But ever since then, Israel has been my only home.
Amazing. Well, Shannon, thank you so much for joining us and giving us your incredibly inspiring story. And we look forward to staying in touch and hearing more. And we just want to thank you. I am so inspired by it, and I'm sure everyone watching is inspired as well.
Thank you.
Thanks so much for watching. For more content, like and subscribe, and be sure to tune in live every Thursday at 8 p.m. Eastern at theshabbatshow.com or right here on YouTube.